A couple of things before we start. Good evening, sir.
Yes.
A couple of things before we start. Yesterday, in spite of the reminder, there were a couple of phones which rang. Please be careful that it doesn't happen. Secondly, try and sign your attendance as soon as you come in. We had organized it today. Those who are coming in late, please come and give the attendance to me after the session is over. So I will not circulate the attendance sheet in between so that it doesn't disturb and the attendance sheet also doesn't get disturbed. Thank you so much. Over to you, sir.
So, friends, today there will be some progress, not only in our subject, but on the in the field of display. So perhaps I will not write anything on the board there. Most of the things will be shown here. But if necessary, I will write some words on that board also. Now, yesterday's lecture was a kind of introduction to this subject. There are still some points which are remaining, and today we are going to discuss these points and see these three words. So, magic, religion, and science. Now, what is the concept of magic? What is the concept of religion? And what is the concept of science? So, briefly, we can say that magic and science, these two are the methodologies of explaining cause and effect relationship. And in a sense, we can say that magic and science, they are opposite to each other. They try to explain cause and effect relationship, but the way of explanation of cause and effect relationship in magic is based upon superstitions. And the cause and effect relationship based upon science depends upon observation and experiments. So magic and science, they are antipodes of each other. I will give one or two examples of magic. A man comes out of his house and he wants to go to carry out some work, but suddenly a cat comes and it crosses the road, and then he believes that he will be unsuccessful in the work which he is going to do because the cat draws a line, as it were, which is not directly seen by us. But suppose I am going and a wall comes in between, I cannot go. Similarly, that line creates a hindrance and I cannot go, and therefore I will be not successful in my work. So this type of belief is magic. There are hundreds of superstitions and in different countries there are different superstitions. We here laugh at the superstitions of others. Other people laugh at our superstitions. In Europe or America, if you go to a hotel, you will not find a room the number of which is 13. So after 12, immediately there is the number 14. Because 13 is considered to be an inauspicious number. And some ghosts, they are powerful in that room. So people try to avoid staying there. An Indian man does not feel any problem in staying in room number 13, but a Western man will try to avoid it. In India itself also, in different parts of the country, there are different superstitions. In Maharashtra, the new moon day, Amavasya day, is considered to be inauspicious. But in South India, it is considered to be auspicious. There was a student, he wanted to submit his PhD thesis. That student was working under my guidance. And the day on which that student wanted to submit the thesis was an Amavasya day. So I told that student to submit next day. But because that student was belonging to Bangalore, that student said, no, there is no harm. Amavasya is a very auspicious day. So I will definitely submit it. And the student did submit the thesis. And of course, the student was successful in spite of all my superstitions. But there are numerous superstitions, and they are based upon a kind of false cause and effect relationship. This cause and effect relationship is based upon sometimes similarity and sometimes on contact. So you know, previously there were numerous superstitions regarding contact also in India. Some people used to be considered as untouchable or inauspicious. Now some of these superstitions have been removed now, and now it is legally banned to observe some of these superstitions. There are many people who fight against the superstitions, but in spite of all these things, some superstitions do continue even today. And as and when science progresses, many superstitions will be abandoned. Previously, a widow was considered to be an inauspicious woman. But now there is a lot of change, and widows are also accepted in the main course of this society, and so on. So everything depends upon science. We do not know the cause and effect relationship, how a particular disease is caused. But once it is known, and the medicines are also known, then people are not afraid of those diseases. Now these many diseases have been eradicated. Previously there was a disease like smallpox. Hundreds of people used to be affected by that disease. But now this disease has been fully eradicated. It was called Devi. And it was supposed that there are some goddesses who cause these diseases. Actually, the diseases which cause child death, there were no names in India previously, and these diseases were personified and they were called Balagrahas. And in order to pacify these Balagrahas, some sacrifices used to be performed, and people in spite of these sacrifices, they used to die. Many children used to die. Hardly one out of 10 children used to survive. Some 50 years ago, this was the condition. But now, only 1 out of 10 or 1 out of 100 dies. Otherwise, the children are generally healthy. So science is progressing and cause and effect relationship is now understood. But in between, there is one stage which we call religion. In religion, the most important concept is that of God. It is believed that God controls the cause and effect relationship. And if I am a devotee of a God, God will protect me. If I am an atheist or I do not believe in God, then I will be punished by God. So people are afraid of gods and they try to please the God. So God is supposed to be omnipotent, omnipresent and omniscient. So he is everywhere. He is all powerful and he knows everything. So therefore, if a man worships a God, then even if he is kept in fire, he will not be burnt. You know the story of Prahlad. He was thrown from a height of mountain, but because he was a devotee of Vishnu, he did not die. Numerous efforts were made in order to kill Prahlad, but he did not die because he was worshipping God Vishnu. On the other hand, demons and many evil beings, they are always killed. You know, Hindi cinema, the villain always is killed by the hero, and hero becomes successful because he is a worshipper of God. He is a good man. And bad people always suffer, at least in stories. There is a proverb in Italy that only poor people go to jail. This is also true in India, but in ancient India it was believed that only bad people go to jail or they are killed, they suffer due to some religions. But if they worship God, then they will be successful. They will survive all types of difficulties. So there are examples like an elephant who was caught by a crocodile and he threw one lotus towards Vishnu, and otherwise that elephant could not have been saved. But because he became a devotee of Vishnu, he was saved from the crocodile. So Gajendra Moksha, this story is very frequently quoted by those who give religious sermons. So God is such a superpower that you can get rain without clouds. Even if you are in fire, you will not be burnt. And if you are against God, if you commit some mistake, then God will punish you, even though you may be very powerful. Because God is a superpower. And therefore, the best way to please the God is to worship Him. And there are numerous ways of worshipping. You can mutter the name of Vishnu or some other God. So there are 9 types of bhakti, navavidha bhakti, archanam, mandanam, dasyam, etc. So that is the way of worshipping God. So now the Vedic literature and the mythology, this topic we are dealing with. This topic belongs to these first two topics, namely magic and religion. So in Vedic literature, many times we find magic or religion. There is a famous hymn in the Atharvaveda. There it, the magician says, Muncha Mitva Avisha Jivanayakam. So I release you from the disease. So see how confident that physician is. He says, I will release you from disease. So this is magic. The magician feels confident, and many followers of magicians, they also believe in miracles, and suddenly some miracle will happen, and suppose somebody is suffering from jaundice, because jaundice and yellow color, these two things are connected. A yellow bird is tied to the bed of the patient, and then it is believed that the yellowness will flow into that yellow bird and the patient will be cured. So this is magic. But many times we come to know that in spite of such devices, patient does not get cured, he dies. Then we start praying God. So, Aushadham Janhavi Toyam Vaidyo Narayano Harihi. So God Vishnu is the physician. If he is favorable, he will save us. And in different religions, God is the central point. The names may be different, but God is considered to be a superpower, and the worshippers or the devotees of that particular deity, they feel that they will be helped by God. So this is what religion means. And Vedic literature is full of magic and religion. So therefore I call it magico-religious way of thinking. And Vedic rituals, Vedic songs, prayers, all these are full of magico-religious elements. Again, in magic, there are two types of magics. One is called black magic and another one is called white magic. So white magic is that which is performed for the sake of good purpose or auspicious purposes. For example, in order to cure a patient, in order to get rain, in order to get money, in order to get wealth, whatever magic is done, it is called white magic. And black magic means the magic which is done in order to destroy others or in order to kill the enemy. So, in order to kill enemy, a person may prepare an idol of the enemy and pierce it with the help of some pins, and then he believes that the enemy will be killed by some arrow, or he will cut a lime fruit and he believes that the head of the enemy will also be cut. So all these things come under black magic, and there is a lot of black magic in Rigveda, in Yajurveda, Not only in Atharvaveda, people believe that only Atharvaveda contains magical rites. It is not correct. Everywhere there is magic, and both white magic as well as black magic. In Rigveda also there is black magic, in Yajurveda also black magic. Almost at every step there is magic and religion. So with this background in our mind, let us now study individual deities. So now we will deal with some deities, but before that we also have to remember that Vedic mythology is closely connected with some other mythologies also, and we can study the word mythology in a comparative way. So there is a branch called comparative mythology, and particularly there are many similarities in Avestan mythology and Vedic mythology. Avesta is a sacred text of Parsis. They were in ancient India, in ancient period they were staying in Iran, but some 5 or 6 centuries ago they came to India as refugees, and for last 4 or 5 centuries they are staying mainly in Gujarat. There are many Parsis in Mumbai, in Gujarat, near Navsari and some other places. Some of the Parsis have also gone to Calcutta, or they are staying in England and some other places. But their sacred text is Avesta, and there are many similarities between Avestan language and Vedic language. So the grammar and vocabulary of Avesta and Rigveda is very much similar. And sometimes with a little change in some letters, we can convert Avestan formulae into Rigvedic formulae. And some words, obviously, they are so close to each other that we can easily recognize that these two languages must be once belonging to the same type of people. For example, there is a word Soma in Vedic literature, and in Avesta there is a word Om. So in the place of So in Vedic literature, we find Ho in Avestan language, or we can call it ancient or old Persian. Similarly, there is a word Asura in the Veda. It also occurs in classical Sanskrit, but the Vedic meaning of the word Asura and the meaning of that word in classical Sanskrit is very much different. In classical Sanskrit, the word Asura stands for some evil beings, enemies of gods, and the word Asura was split into A and Sura. That is not God. And the new word Sura has been created in classical Sanskrit in the sense of God. In Vedic language, we do not get the word Sura, but we do get the word Asura. And the word Asura is used as an epithet of many gods. For example, Varuna is often called Asura. But not only Varuna, even other gods like Mitra or Savitru, Agni, and many other gods are also called Asura. And there, the word Asura does not mean not God, but rather it means powerful. So the etymology of the word Asura is from the word Asu. Asu means life power. In classical Sanskrit also the word asu is used in the sense of breath or life power. It is equivalent to the word prana. Prana and asu mean the same in classical Sanskrit. So, and ra is a suffix. It is called possessive suffix. So, asura means one who possesses life power. So, ultimately it means powerful. We see this suffix ra in the sense of possession in some other words also. Take for example the word madhura. So, madhura, there are two parts, madhu plus ra. So, madhu means honey, and that which contains honey is madhura, that is sweet. But the etymology of the word madhura is madhu plus ra. Just as in classical Sanskrit we have suffix mat or vat in the sense of possession, buddhimat, dhanavat. Similarly, ra was a possessive suffix, and asura means one who possesses power, that is powerful. And therefore this word is used not in the sense of demons but in the sense of powerful, and many gods in Veda are described to be asuras, or they are called asura, asura varuna, etc. There are some other concepts also which we find in the Vedic literature and also in Avestan literature. And the most important concept is that of Ruta. Ruta is a very important concept in Vedic literature. In classical Sanskrit, the word Ruta means true, but in Vedic literature, it has slightly a different meaning. The word Ruta is derived from the root Ru. Ru means to go. And Ruta literally means the act of going, and secondarily it means discipline, and it is connected with the English word order. So Ruta means order, that is discipline. And the word Ruta is a very important concept in Veda. In classical Sanskrit this concept was forgotten, and therefore simply it means true. But there is a corresponding concept in Avesta, and that concept is called Asha. So the word Asha is exactly similar to Ruta, which also means, and Asha also means order or discipline. So the ancient people, that is Vedic people, they must have observed that there is some kind of discipline in the worldly happenings. There is some kind of order. We see the seasons. So after summer, rainy season comes. After rainy season, there is winter. So there are mainly three seasons in India. But they are further classified. Sometimes they are described to be six, sometimes they are said to be seven, sometimes their number is described to be five, sometimes four, sometimes two, and sometimes one also. So in Vedic literature, we have all types of examples where the number of seasons in year are said to be seven, six, five, four, three, or two, or one. So there is no fixed rule regarding the number of seasons, because in different parts of country there are different seasons. So there are some parts where there is only hot season, that is summer there is, and there is no winter at all. On the other hand, there are some parts where there is always winter, there is snow, and so on. There are some places where there is excessive rain, there are some parts where there is no rain at all, and so on. So the number of seasons changes, but there is some order or some discipline as far as the seasons are considered. Similarly, there is also some kind of order in sunrise, sunset, or the digits of moon, and so many things. So an ordinary man also observes these things, even though he may not be a scientist. He observes these things and he feels that there is some kind of discipline, and this discipline can be called Ruta, or in Avesta it is called Asha. But who maintains this order? That is the question. Whether it is simply belonging to rules of nature, or is there any kind of divine power behind this Ruta? That is the question. So those who are believing in God power, they consider that there must be some divine power behind this concept of Ruta. And Varuna or some other gods, they are said to be maintaining this law and order in nature. So in Avesta also we get such descriptions, and in Vedic literature also we get such descriptions, where gods are described to be lords who maintain this law and order, that is Ruta. Similarly, there is a concept of some gods like solar divinities. In Sanskrit or in Vedic literature, they are called Adityas. And there are numerous Adityas. Sometimes the number is said to be 8, sometimes 7, sometimes 12, sometimes 5. But these Adityas, they are the forms of sun. And one of the Adityas is called Bhaga in Vedic literature. And the word Bhaga is connected with luck. And in classical Sanskrit, we get the word Bhagya, which is an abstract noun derived from the word Bhaga. And there is a similar concept in Avesta also. And the god is called Bhaga. So instead of Bha, we get Bha. So Bhaga. And there are some such similarities. But there are some dissimilarities also between Vedic religion and Avestan religion. So sometimes we find that those who are worshipped or considered to be respectable gods, they are described as demons in Avesta. For example, in Vedic literature, Indra was a very highly honored god. But the corresponding word in Avesta is Andhra Mainyu. So this Andhra Mainyu is just another form of Indra, but he is supposed to be an evil being, and there are sometimes quarrels of this god and other gods. And in Avesta, many times there are some pairs of words. One of them is used in good sense, and another one is used in bad sense. For example, there are two words in the sense of hand in Avestan language. One is kara, as in Sanskrit. There is also a word kara in Avestan language. And there is another word, jasta, which is corresponding to the word hasta in Sanskrit language. But the word kara is used in a good sense. So the hand of a good man is called kara, and the hand of a bad man is called jasta. In modern languages also, there are some words used in good sense and some other words are used in bad sense. In Marathi, the mother, when she loves her child, she will say, "Eat this morsel of a crow or of a sparrow. कौसा घास घे अचिबूचा घास घे असं म्हणून प्रेमाने ती खाऊ घालते. पण त्या सावत्र मुलाला मात्र म्हणताना गिळ असं ते म्हणते. सो दी वर्ड गिळ अँड ॲक्च्युली खा, दी मीनिंग इज सेम, बट वन मीनिंग इज यूज, वन मीनिंग इज गुड अँड अनदर मीनिंग इज बॅड. सो इफ ए रिस्पेक्टेबल पर्सन डाईज, ही इट इज सेड दॅट ही वेंट टू कैलास और ही वेंट टू वैकुंठ और ही पंचतोंगत. बट इफ ए बॅड मॅन डाईज और इफ युअर एनिमी डाईज, यू विल यूज तो चचला. तर चचणं आणि मरणं, सो यू विल नॉट यूज द वर्ड चचणं इन द सेन्स ऑफ ए गुड मॅन और अ रिस्पेक्टेबल मॅन. बट ए बॅड मॅन डाईज, यू विल यूज द वर्ड और the person who is hated by you, when he dies, the word chasne, this is used. There may be similar words in other languages also, and some words which are used in good sense and some words are used in bad sense, but there are such words in Avestan language also. So Andhra Manyu, which corresponds to Indra, so this is a bad personality in Avesta. But Indra is a very respectable personality. He is a very popular god in Vedic literature. There is a very large number of hymns addressed to Indra. So, in this way, there are some similarities, some dissimilarities between Vedic language and Avestan language, ancient Vedic religion and ancient Persian religion. There are some similarities between Indian mythology and Greek mythology also. So, in the beginnings of 19th century only, it was noticed by some linguists that the word Dyauhu Pitar corresponds to the word Jupiter, and there must be some similarities between Greek, Latin, Sanskrit and some other languages in ancient days. So they took for granted that there must be some language which must be at the origin of all these languages. And this language was called Indo-European language. And Sanskrit or Greek or Latin and many other languages were supposed to be born out of this Indo-European language. This Indo-European language is a kind of hypothetical language. We do not get any literature in this language. The word Indo-European also is a modern word. No such word is used in ancient days. But the people in Germany, they are very proud of their own country. So they do not use the word Indo-European, they always use the word Indo-Germanic language. So Indo-Germanic language is also a kind of hypothetical language, and Sanskrit is a child of this Indo-Germanic language or Indo-European language. And out of Sanskrit, some more languages were afterwards created or they took form. Of course, in the field of linguistics, there is a lot of difference of opinion, and you may utter any theory, you will find some opponents and they will not accept that theory. So many people do not accept the concept of Indo-European. Some people say that Sanskrit is the mother of all other languages, not only in India but all the languages in the world. So they will try to find out some similarities, verbal similarities, and they will say that every word is connected with Sanskrit. And you can say that they are Sanskrit chauvinists. So they say that Sanskrit is the highest or the best type of language. But everybody is free to have his own opinions. But the point here is that we do observe many similarities between Sanskrit and Greek or Latin and some other languages, and there are many corresponding words in each language. I mentioned that in Sanskrit there is wherever there is sa, in Avesta we get ha, and even in later Persian also we find that there is a word hazar, and in Sanskrit there is a word sahasra. So sa has become ha in that language. So there are many such correspondences. Even in Urdu and Sanskrit also there are many correspondences. So it is our duty to find out similarities or dissimilarities, and we can have our own theories. Now, after all these preliminary remarks, now we directly enter into the Vedic mythology proper. And now we will deal with some of the Vedic deities, and we will start with the god Varuna. Varuna is the most important deity in the Rigveda particularly. And yesterday I mentioned the name of one scholar who has written a book in German, and his name is Günterth. So Günterth has written a book on Varuna, and he has called Varuna to be king of world. So he has used the word Weltkönig, that is king of world. And he is a supreme god. And although the number of hymns addressed to Varuna is comparatively small, because there are numerous hymns addressed to Indra, there are numerous hymns addressed to Agni, still the importance of Varuna, we feel that Varuna was the highest god in Vedic period. So therefore, now we will deal with God Varuna, and we will see some of his descriptions in Rigveda and some other literature. Now, Surya or the sun is said to be the eye of Varuna. So he is described as Chakshuhu Mitrasya Varunasya Agnehe. So sun is the eye of Mitra or Varuna or Agni. Varuna is also described to be Ugra. He is called Ugraha Sahasra Chakshaha. Ugra, in Marathi we use the word Ugra in the sense of dangerous, but that is not the meaning of the word Ugra in Sanskrit or in classical Sanskrit or even in Vedic literature. The word Ugra means powerful. So remember this concept of power. There are numerous words in Sanskrit which are used in the sense of power. And gods are supposed to be symbols of power. They are described to be powerful. And therefore, the word Ugra is used in the sense of powerful. A Dutch scholar, namely Konda, he has written a book on the word Ojas in Veda. And the word Ojas also means power. And the word Ugra is connected with the word Ojas. And again you will find that there is a Ra. And Ra is a possessive suffix, as I mentioned. So Ugra means one who possesses power, that is powerful. So he is called, Varuna is called powerful. and the description of God, as I mentioned earlier, omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient. This is applicable to Varuna very much, and he is called Uru Chakshas. That is one whose vision is very broad. Uru means broad, and Uru Chakshas, that is one who sees very widely. Not only widely, he sees everything, because he is all-knowing, omniscient God. He is omnipotent, he is omnipresent, he is everywhere. He is also called Sahasra Chakshaha, that is one who has 1,000 eyes. When I was in school, there was a teacher. He used to say, a teacher has 1,000 eyes. So he used to observe all the students, and he used to punish those students who were not paying attention to him. Of course, he was a very good teacher, and because I am not a very good teacher, I do not have 1,000 eyes, and I cannot see everything here. But Varuna has 1,000 eyes, and he is called Sahasra Chakshaha. Then he is also called Kshatrashriya, Kshatrashri. So Kshatrashri, next one. So he is described as Kshatrashriyam. A devotee says, when I will be able to see Varuna, who is having the power or the beauty of a king, Kshatra. Kshatra means royal power. He has royal power, and therefore he is called Kshatrashri. And there is a kind of physical description of Varuna also. So he is described as Bibhradrapim. There seems to be some mistake there. Actually, the word drapi, it should be drapim, there should be anuswara there. And drapi, this word, we can compare the English word drapery. So it is a kind of garment, or roughly you can call a cloak. Marathi jala jhaga mantat. Tasa ek soneri jhaga. So hiranyaya, tar जुन्या नाटकांमध्ये वगैरे तुम्ही जर बघितलं असेल तर राजे किंवा सरदार वगैरे मंडळी ही काही विशिष्ट प्रकारचा जगा घालत असत. आता तसा काही कोणी घालत नाही, परंतु नाटकामध्ये तशा प्रकारचा पोशाख करत केला जात असे. अँड पर्टिक्युलरली किंग ही यूज टू हॅव धिस टाईप ऑफ द्रापी, अ काइंड ऑफ क्लोक. अँड धिस क्लोक वॉज हिरण्यय, दॅट इज गोल्डन. अँड ही ऑल्सो वेअर्स such garment, nirnija, vasta, that is, he has, he wears such a garment and such a armor. So roughly, the word drapi can be translated as the armor. And it is golden armor. Now, in Shatavata Brahmana, there is a description of a particular ritual. And this ritual is a part of Ashwamedha sacrifice. This is a very strange type of ritual, but very interesting one. We do not know whether it was actually performed or not. So the idea is that in the Ashwamedha sacrifice, there is a particular rite in which a man who is white, one who has baldness, so bald-headed, khalati, and pingaksha, that is yellowish eyes. Such a person used to be placed in water, and on his head an oblation of ghee used to be offered. And then it is said that this type of man is a form of Varuna. And thereby, when one performs this ritual, Sakshadeva Varunam Avayajate. So one removes Varuna by making this offering. So this man, who is white colored, with yellowish eyes, bald headed, and so on, was supposed to be a form of Varuna. And by performing this particular ritual, one removes Varuna. So Varuna was a god. People used to be frightened out of Varuna. They were afraid of Varuna because they believed that he would punish us. He is a very cruel god. And most of the gods in Vedic literature, and not only in Vedic literature, even in classical period or epic and Puranic gods also, they are double-natured gods. And double-natured god means they can be extremely kind and they can be extremely cruel also. If you worship them, they will be very much kind and you will get anything you want to get. And if they become angry, they will take away everything, whatever you have. If you have read the Satyanarayan Katha, which is comparatively a very modern story, it was composed in the 18th century only. Although it is claimed that it belongs to Skanda Purana, Iti Shri Skanda Purane, Reva Khande, etc., these words are used there. But in the available Skanda Purana, we do not get Satyanarayana Katha. And perhaps it was created in imitation of the worship of Sacha Peer in Bengal. And instead of Peer, they put Narayana. Satyanarayan, and in imitation of Satyanarayan, numerous other stories also were created. For example, there is Satya Vinayak story, there is Satya Datta, Satya Durga, and numerous other deities. But the stories are very much similar to each other, whatever may be the name of God there. He is extremely kind and he is extremely cruel. So there is a story in Satyanarayan that there was one person, he declared that he would perform Satyanarayan worship. Then immediately he got a lot of success. But later on he forgot to perform this. Then immediately all his wealth disappeared and he became poor. And there are many such stories in Satyanarayana Vrata Katha. So gods are very much angry, they can be very much pleased. In one word, they are double-natured, very kind or very cruel. So Gundert, I mentioned his name, so Gundert has described God Varuna to be similar to a sultan. He has used the word sultan, that is a ruler, a king who is extremely whimsical. You know the many stories of Birbal and Bacha, and there you will find how that king is very whimsical. Easily he becomes angry, easily he becomes pleased. But persons like Birbal, they are extremely wise persons. So they can behave properly with that king. But even they also have to suffer on account of the anger of that Badshah. The point is that Varuna is similar to that type of sultan. So he becomes angry and he will punish. And therefore, people used to be frightened and they used to avoid him. And therefore, it is said that Sakshadeva Varunam Avayajati. So he tries to remove Varuna. And if you read these words, Shukla, Khalati, Pingaksha, etc., if you are a student of classical Sanskrit literature and dramaturgy, you will remember that similar description of Vidushaka is given in Sanskrit dramaturgy. So Varuna also, just as Varuna is Khalati, Vidushaka also should be a Khalati, that is bald-headed person. He should be also a man with yellowish eyes. And I have written a paper on Vidushaka, and I have said that Vidushaka represents Varuna, he is a symbol of Varuna. And Vidushaka also, generally we consider Vidushaka as a person who creates some laughter, but actually he is also magically potent person. And because of Vidushaka, you can get sometimes failure or success. So therefore, a king or rich people used to keep Vidushaka, and they used to remain in the company of Vidushakas, because in order to protect themselves from the bad sight of the evil persons, they used to maintain Vidushaka, and they used to remain in the company of Vidushaka. And Vidushaka is a kind of small loss on the part of a person in order to get bigger gain. As you know, if you go in the morning on the streets, you will find in every restaurant, one cup of tea is thrown on the street. So a loss is done purposefully with the idea that there will be a lot of gain with the help of that loss. Similarly, Vidushaka is a kind of loss on the part of a rich man or on the part of a king. He creates sometimes some problems also. You know the stories of Mrishyakatika and many other dramas, even in Abhijnana Shakuntala. But ultimately, it is useful and one gets lot of profit. Therefore, Vidushaka is a kind of loss, small loss, in order to get big profit. And that is based upon the superstition that a little or small loss leads to big gain. So there are some people in the evening of marriage, they quarrel with each other. Why? Because thereby they believe that there will be no quarrel afterwards between the husband and wife. So in order to avoid the big quarrel, they purposefully do some little quarrel. That is, small loss leads to great profit. That is the magical way of thinking. It is a superstition, that is true. Some of you may laugh at this superstition, but those who have faith in superstitions also, they do all these things very seriously and they do not laugh at these things. So the point is that Varuna is avoided because he is a dangerous god. And Sakshadeva Varunam Avayajate. Now, the next point is that Varuna is described to be Rutasya Gopaha, that is the protector of Ruta. I have already mentioned the power of Ruta. It is a kind of discipline. And if there will be no discipline in the world, it will be difficult to maintain the world. So who protects, who looks after this law and order? It is Varuna. Varuna is the protector of Ruta, and therefore he is called Rutasya Gopaha. Then he is further described as dhritam vrataha. The word vrata also stands for rules. So one who observes rules. So it is just another type of description of rutasya gopaha, dhritam vrataha. That is one who has observed rules. He not only observes rules, he makes others observe rules. And if we break these rules, he punishes. So such as he is, he sits, nifasad means he sits, pastyasu, due to pastya means water, he is sitting in water. And therefore, Varuna is supposed to be in later or classical Sanskrit, god of water. And you may be knowing the motto of Indian Navy, Shanno Varunaha, because Navy is connected with ocean and Varuna is supposed to be the god of oceans because he sits in water. So Varunaha Pastyasu Nihasad and Paris Pasho Nihedire, the word Spash means spy. And the spies are sitting around Varuna. So Pari means around, Nishedire means they have been sitting. So he is surrounded by spies. And through these spies, he observes the behavior, whether good or bad, of men. And therefore, he is aptly called the king, or I use the word sultan. He is a badshah. And he is very whimsical, but he is also sometimes extremely cruel. But he can be kind, and therefore he is said, Vishvesham Varunasi Raja, you are the king of all people. Next one. And then, there is a question. But before that, we will say that how Varuna is described to be omniscient. He knows everything. And now you see, there is a description, Vedayo Veenam Padamantarikshena Patatam. Veda, that is, he knows. Pada means the foot. Literally it means foot. And secondly, it means the foot traces. He knows the foot traces even of birds which are flying through the air, antarikshena patatam. Now see the root pata. In classical Sanskrit, the root pata is used in the sense of falling down. But in Vedic language, the root pata means to fly. Of course, flying means going or falling upwards. And falling means flying downwards. So in both ways, it is some kind of movement, but the direction is different. When we go up, we call flying. We are flying. And when we go downwards, we call we are falling. But actually, Durpata is used in the sense of flying. If it is used, Utplapata means fly up, and Nipata means fly down or fall down. So those who are flying in the air, or antariksha, that is sky, even these birds, how they move, that has been counted by Varuna. In classical Sanskrit also, you get the word patra in the sense of feather, or the word patatra, patanga, in the sense of bird, and there is the root pata. Pata means to fly. So he knows all the birds. He also knows the ships, navaha, samudriyaha, that is those ships which are wandering in the ocean. He knows everything. And then, see the next one. Veda vatasya vartanim. Next one. So, he knows the behavior of wind also, how wind flows. that also he knows. So see the descriptions, how minutely it has been done. He is an omniscient God, so he knows how wind blows. Similarly, he sees the good and bad activities of all the people. So satyanrute avapashyan jananam. So he sees the good things as well as bad things, truth and untruth of the people. And the next line is very important. Sankhyata asya nimiho jananam. So the word nimih means the act of winking. So he has counted the act of winking of every person. We close our eyes open, but we are never aware of this act of winking. But Varuna knows, he has counted the number of winkings of every person. We consider it as a reflex action and we do not pay attention to the act of winking. But Varuna has counted, sankhyataha, that is counted, nimishaha, that is the act of winking of people. Similarly, in the next line there is a description which makes it clear how Varuna is omnipresent. So dvau sannihadya. Sannihadya means having sit together, having sat together. When two people are making conversation, yan mantrayete, that is they discuss with each other, raja tadved. So God, Varuna, he is a king and he knows it and he is present there as the third person. Sometimes we consider that we are doing something very secretly and we do not know that there is somebody present there and it is Varuna who is present there. So he is present there, he is omnipresent, he is omnipotent and omniscient. So this has been described in a very effective manner in this line. Now one more important point is that, as I mentioned, people are afraid of Varuna. They think that Varuna will punish them. And why does he punish? Because the misdeeds one has performed or one has done. So if one commits some mistakes, immediately Varuna punishes him. And the best way to be free from his punishment is to confess. So by confessing one's sin, one becomes reduced or free from sin. So to declare sin and to declare one's own merit has one similarity. In either case, it is reduced. So if you declare your sin, it will be reduced. And if you declare your merit, then also it will be reduced. So if you say and confess that I have committed a mistake, then the seriousness of that mistake is reduced. But if you say that I am a very generous person, I have given 2 crore rupees to Bhandarak Institute, then the merit will be reduced. So you should not declare that you are generous or you are a very good person. It should be kept secret. But in order to reduce the graveness of sin, you should confess it. And the way of punishment of Varuna is he ties the sinners by means of nooses. And the word noose is used in the next line, pasha. So with the help of snares, Varuna ties the sinners. And there are 3 types of snares, upper one, middle one, and the lower one. In Hindi cinema, you might have seen many times the villain ties the heroine and also hero. But why does he immediately does not kill them? Otherwise the cinema will end there itself. but he does not kill them. But slowly, slowly, the hero removes the ties of heroine, and heroine removes the ties of hero, and both of them, they become free. And then they start beating the villain, and ultimately they become successful. So a prayer is made, Uduttamam Mumukdhino Vipasham Madhyamam Chrita. So Uttama means the upper snares. So the snares with the help of which the, perhaps the chest was tied, and Madhyama, that is by means of which the belly was tied, and Adhama means the lower one. So these snares should be removed by Varuna. That type of prayer is made. And the punishment which is given by Varuna is in the form of disease. And the disease is called Jalodara. In English, it is called dropsy. So the person who commits sins or does some mistakes, he suffers from dropsy. His belly swells, and then ultimately it bursts and he dies. So in order to be free from that type of disease, one should confess your sin, and then Varuna will cure you, because he not only creates diseases, he can cure also. Because he is double-natured God. He is very kind-hearted also, he is very cruel also. And therefore, it is said that Shatam te rajan bhishaja sahasram. So you have hundreds of or thousands of medicines. So bhishaj, the word bhishaj means literally ointment. How the word bhishaj is derived? Abhi plus saja is the root. And in this suffix abhi, a is dropped. So abhisaja becomes bhishaj. There are some other prefixes also in Sanskrit where the a is dropped, just as in the word pidhana, apidhana is called pidhana. Or instead of ava plus gaiya, gaha, so vagaiha, this form is used in the sense of avagaiya. So a is dropped. So many times a is added, many times a is dropped. So pidhana, vagahana. Similarly here, abhi, a is dropped. And many times a is added also, just for the sake of convenience of the pronunciation. So for example, in Marathi, we use the word aparoksha. Aparoksha literally means without seeing, or without having noticed. Actually, the word paroksha means without having seen, but a is used there. In Sanskrit, the word aparoksha means directly, having seen directly. But in Marathi, the word aparoksha means having not seen. So how that a is to be explained? It is to be explained as a kind of convenience of pronunciation. Just as some people utter the word stri as istri, in the same way, paroksha is uttered as aparoksha, for the sake of convenience of easiness of the word. There are some other words also. On All India Radio, when Venkatesh Madgulkar used to utter some words, he never used to say Ram Ram, he used to say A Ram Ram. So that Ram Ram, actually, A is added, that A is not a part of Naya Tatpurush compound, it is for the sake of convenience of pronunciation. So there are many people in the area near Solapur, they add A before many words. Now here, Abhishaja is changed into Bhishaj, and Bhishaj means ointment, but then afterwards it is used in the sense of medicine. So you have hundreds of medicines, okay. So he can cure, and one can be free from diseases if one is the worshipper of Varuna. And see the next line, Sinantu Sarve Anrutam Vadantam. So one who speaks untruth, let all snares bind him. And on the other hand, Yaha Satyavadi, one who confesses the truth, he should be free. So Atitam Srijantu means may they release him from those snares. And this point I already told you, confession leads to freedom from sin and freedom from disease. So this is a very important way of curing patients in magico-religious way. And when actual medicines were not known, confession was one of the ways of curing patient. And I have written a book on the magico-religious aspects of ancient Indian medicine, and I have dealt with confession there, and I have referred to all these references. Now, one more important part of the worship of Varuna is mysticism. So let us now go to the next point, that is mysticism. The word mysticism is generally translated into Marathi with the word Gudavad. That is the literal translation of the word mystic. Mystic means good. But better it will be to translate the word mysticism with the word Sakshatkarvad. So Sakshatkar means direct perception. So wherever there are descriptions of direct perception of God, all these descriptions are mystic, because these experiences are extremely personal. When Saint Namdev says, Nama mane maza deva sapadala, how can we verify this? If he says that he has seen God, he has found God, how can we verify this? It is not a part of science, it is a part of mysticism. And there are numerous descriptions in saint literature of saints or in Vedic literature where we find mysticism. And in the hymns addressed to Varuna, we find mysticism in the Rigveda. So, a book has been written on this topic, mysticism in the Rigveda. It is written by Dr. Mainkar. It is available in our library. So, there are some references where one says that I have seen God Varuna. I went to see Varuna and he was staying in a Brihantam Manam. So, Mana, the word Mana means house. It is connected with the English word mansion. So, Brihantam Manam. So, big house. Varuna has a very big house. And I went there. And this house has 100 pillars. So, such a big house it was. And there I saw Varuna. Vasishtha says that I went to see Varuna. Elsewhere it is said that Vasishtham Varuno Navi Adhat. So, Navi, that is in ship. Vasishtha was put in a ship by Varuna and they went on a voyage, and when they went to the very central part of the ocean, and there Varuna gave some mystic knowledge to Vasishtha. So it was Varuna who made Vasishtha a sage. So, he made him Ruhi or a sage. All these descriptions are mystic description. We cannot verify, we cannot ask question whether really Varuna came there, how Varuna was pleased with Vasishtha, why was he pleased with Vasishtha. We do not know. But such descriptions are there, and these descriptions are available in Rigveda and in other parts of Vedic literature also. There is another line, Vasishtha says that he saw the face of Varuna and it was like fire. So, Agne Ranikam Varunasya Mausi. There is a printing mistake there. It is not Mausi, that is Maushi. Actually, the word is Mausi. Mana is the root. So Manu means I supposed, I thought that Varuna's face is like that of Varuna. The word Anika, Anika means face. Actually the word Anika is derived from the root Ana. Ana means to breathe. There are many words where we get the word Ana, Prana, Apana, Vyana, Udana, Samana, etc. Everywhere there is the root Ana. Ana means to breathe. And Anika means the means of breathing, that is face. So face of Varuna was similar to that of Agni. So these descriptions are a part of mysticism, and mysticism is a very important aspect of Varuna's devotion. Now, within a few minutes, now we will discuss another deity, namely Mitra. So Mitra is a comparatively minor deity because there is only one hymn addressed to Mitra. Mitra also is a solar deity. It is one of the forms of the sun. In classical literature, the word Mitra means sun. There are numerous names of sun and Mitra is one of them. But in Vedic literature, Surya is different from Mitra, although there are some similarities between Mitra and Surya. There is another word like Savitru, which also means sun, but Savitru also is different from Surya, he is different from Mitra. So all these deities are solar deities, but they are not exactly sun. You can describe them to be solar deities. And this one verse is very important in connection with Mitra. Mitro janan yatayati. So this word yatayati is very important. And yatayati means arranges. He makes the arrangement among the people. He arranges the people. So Mitro janan yatayati. That is, he arranges people. And he has supported Mitro dadhar prithivi mutadyam. He has supported the earth. He has supported the heaven. Now everybody has this doubt, why the sun or moon or some other stars which we see in the sky, why don't they fall on the earth? The answer given by Vedic scholars is that it is Mitra who has supported them. So Mitra has held the earth also, therefore the earth also doesn't fall, and neither the heaven, dyam, that is heaven, also does not fall because it has been supported by Mitra. But we find that these type of descriptions are available in the hymns addressed to other gods also. In connection with Vishnu also, it is said Vishnu has supported the earth. So this is a part of henotheism which I mentioned. So to praise the god in the context with the highest words. So Mitra has supported the earth, Mitra has supported the heaven, and Mitra krishtihi animisha abhichakte. Abhichakte means he looks at krishti. The word krishti literally means the act of ploughing. But secondly it means the people who plough, that is in general, people in general. So he looks at all the people animisha, that is without winking his eyes. So this is a very important concept which we find even in classical Sanskrit. The main difference between gods and men is that men wink, they close their eyes, but gods never close their eyes. Their eyes are always open. And this was how. There is a story of Nala and Damayanti. Damayanti was a beautiful girl and even gods wanted to marry with her. But she was loving Nala. But at the time of the marriage of Damayanti, there were 5 Nalas. All were looking exactly same, because the gods like Agni, Indra, etc., they had also taken the form of Nala. And they were sitting in one row. But because Damayanti had studied Sanskrit literature, she was knowing that gods do not wink and human beings do wink. So she saw all these five persons and she observed that four out of them, their eyes are never closed. And only one person is winking. So he must be real human Nala. And she selected that human Nala. So that is called Panchanali. So in Naishadhi Charitra, there are descriptions, one verse having five meanings. So such descriptions are there. But one difference was there, that is, a man winks, but God never winks. Their eyes, the eyes of gods, are animish, that is, without winking. There is also a slight mistake there, that ni should be short. Animisha abhichaste. And mitraya havyam ghritavat juhota. So do you offer, juhota means offer, an oblation which consists of ghee to Mitra. So this is a very important verse, and where we get the description of Mitra, that is yatayat jana, that is making the arrangement of people in general. And there are some other descriptions of Mitra which are very much similar to the descriptions of Varuna. For example, adabdha. Adabdha means there is a root dabha. Dabha means to cheat. And adabdha means one who is not cheated by anybody. So this word is used in connection with Varuna also, in connection with some other gods also, because nobody can cheat gods, because gods observe everything very minutely, and men can cheat other men, but no one can cheat gods. And therefore he is called adabdha. And very often Mitra and Varuna are mentioned together. There is a Dvandva Devata. This concept is very important. Dvandva Devata. Two gods are mentioned together. But this Dvandva Devata is another deity. So Mitra Varuna is a separate deity. It is separate or different from Mitra. It is also different from Varuna. But it has some hymns addressed to Mitra and Varuna. And the last and important point is the derivation of the word Mitra. The word Mitra is connected with the root Mi. Mi means to bind. And Mitra means bond, literally. And therefore, in Sanskrit, the word Mitra is neuter gender, Mitram, that is bond, in the sense of friendship. So there is an unseen bond between two friends, and therefore they are called Mitra. And the god Mitra is a personification of that god, personification of that bond. So bond personified, Mitra means bond personified. And Gunterit has given the etymology of the word Mitra from the root Mi. And he has also mentioned the word Mekhala, which also may be connected with the root Mi. Mekhala means a belt. And this word is also derived from the root Mi, which means to bind. So Mitra also means binding, or the act of binding. And therefore, there was a kind of agreement between two kings, and that agreement was written on some bricks. And these bricks were excavated near the place called Bogoskoye. And this place is in Turkestan. And there are some words which are similar to the Vedic gods. And the deities like Ashwins or Mitra, they are mentioned there. And this leads us to imagine that the Vedic gods were not only Vedic or Indian gods, they were rather Indo-European gods. And even Avesta and other parts of Europe, there were corresponding names or gods in ancient period. So now I think the time is almost over. There is some time still available for discussion or question and answer. You can ask any question, you can express your views. Even if you have some different views from my own views, you are welcome. But be brief, don't give sermons. That is the most important thing. Okay, thank you. So now you may take this utensil and speak.
Sir, you said that Mitra was supposed to hold the earth and sun. So if earth was supposed to be flat or what?
No, there is no direct mention whether it was flat or round or any other. Because that was not the point, very important in the mind of Vedic people. They were not interested in these questions, whether it is flat or round or something, triangle size or some other size. So these are modern questions. So this is a very important thing. People try to find out modern concepts in Vedic literature. This is a very wrong attitude. This is called anachronism. So our times are different, our problems are different, and the problems before ancient people, Vedic people, they were also different. So don't try to find solutions of modern problems in ancient literature. Similarly, don't try to find out the modern concepts in ancient literature. For example, the problem like ecology is a modern problem. Only during last 50 years, earlier there was no problem of ecology at all. There was no pollution, there was nothing. So hundreds of seminars have been arranged on the awareness of ecology in Vedic literature or some epic literature and so on. This is I call anachronism. Because even today there is no sufficient pollution in India. Because there is no sufficient industrialization in India. As in Germany or in some other countries, there is no that much industrialization. Comparatively, even plastic also is less used in India, although now it is banned. So there is comparatively less pollution. Whatever pollution there is, it is on account of extra population, but not on account of smoke or on account of plastic or some other industrial growth. So don't try to find modern things in ancient literature. Try to understand ancient literature as ancient literature, whether it is useful or not. And therefore I use the word nishkarana. So without any reason or without any purpose, we should study Vedic literature. And it is only meant for the sake of study, for the sake of study, not in order to solve any modern problems, not even in order to get some salary or even increment in our job. It is to be done for the sake of study only. Okay, anything else?
Sir, excuse me. Yes. You told Indra a respectable god.
Yes.
Whatever in Puranas or something, the stories, maybe in the case of Ahalya or something, we have seen Indra is a very bad conduct person, society like that.
That is true. First thing is that Ahalya and some other stories occur in Veda also. So even in Vedic literature also, Indra is described to be Ahalyayai Jaraha. Jara means one who makes old. The word, literal meaning of the word Jara is one who makes old, that is a lover. And he is described, but the main point which you have to remember is that gods are not the symbols of morality, they are symbols of power. So I use this expression that gods are worshipped because they are powerful. Once they lose power, nobody will worship them. Just as a political leader, once he gets defeated in election, nobody pays attention to him. But once he is elected, he is a minister, people will respect him, they will welcome him. Otherwise, nobody will pay attention to him. Same way, gods are worshipped because they are powerful. And one who is not powerful is not worshipped.
and many Indras are there. Indra is only a designation or something. Yes. Like that.
We are going to discuss Indra also tomorrow. But this point you remember, that gods are not symbols of morality, and therefore there is a famous sentence, na deva charitam charet. So one should not imitate the behavior of gods. So if Indra is a jar, you should not be jar of somebody. So let Indra do whatever he wants to do, because he is capable of doing this. Whatever we are capable of, we should do that much only. Okay, anything else?
Sir, you have mentioned that the Varuna being surrounded by so many spies.
Yes.
So can we relate this to its description as Sahasra Chakshaha?
Yes. So there is a frequent reference to spies, and that is a very special peculiarity. And again, this characterizes him as a king. Varuna I described as Sultan or a king. And even in Vedic literature also, he is described as a king. He is sometimes called Samrat. That is not only a simple king, but rather emperor, biggest king. So therefore, he has spies, and through eyes, in the form of spies, he sees everything and comes to know good or bad behavior of human beings. Yes.
Hello, sir. Is there any mention of stars or galaxies in the Vedas which cannot be seen with normal eyes or something?
No, there is no such the concept like galaxy or anything. The word tara or something which means star occurs in Veda, but the concept of galaxy is not there.
Thank you. Thank you for clarifying.
Even the concept of planet is also comparatively later one, not Vedic. In Vedic literature, there is no word like graha in the sense of planet, as it occurs in later literature. The word graha occurs in Veda, but it is used in different sense. Graha literally means taking or scooping. So it is a kind of, you roughly translate it as cup. Graha means a cup in which you can take so much juice. So it is a kind of cup. But it is never used in the sense of planet, and no description, no distinction is made between planets and stars, sun and moon. So sun is a star, moon is a planet in classical astrology, but that is only in later period.
Sir, you were discussing about the Vedic and Avestan forms. So I had to ask one question. You said Devahu Pitara is connected with Jupiter, or the word Jupiter is connected with Devahu Pitara. So I just don't get the connection. How can it be? Like, I have heard the deity Deva Prithivi. So Devahu Pitara, I haven't heard the word.
No, Devahu Pitara, that is sky, is metaphorically described as father, and this word has some similarity with the word Jupiter. And in 19th century, Max Müller has said that this is the greatest discovery of 19th century, that people came to know the equation, Devahu Pitara is identical with Jupiter. To know this was a great discovery at that time, because it gave rise to the whole science of comparative linguistics, comparative mythology, comparative religion, and all these branches were developed because they came to know that there is some similarity between Sanskrit and Greek.
Okay.
And later on, they found out many other similarities also, and the science of comparative linguistics was also developed. So this is a small example. There are some other examples also, words like 1, 2, 3, etc. There are similarities in connection with these words of figures in Sanskrit, and similarly mother, father, brother, etc. There are similarities in connection with these words. So there are some basic similarities between many languages, and that gave the rise to the concept that there must be some original language which can be called Indo-European. Yes.
As Varuna is described as bald and white, is there any physical attributes of Mitra mentioned in the texts?
No, comparatively there are very few descriptions. I said that only one hymn is available in praise of Mitra, and that is why Guntert, the scholar, he has said that Mitra is just another form of Varuna. So he was not an independent deity, but just a form of, just as in later literature we use the word avatar. So you can roughly say that Mitra is an avatar of Varuna. That is another form of Varuna.
Thank you.
Because comparatively, there are very few descriptions of Mitra. And only one word, that is Yatayati Janan, that is a special word. Because this expression is not used in connection with any other god. It is used in connection with Mitra only. So therefore, he is a minor god. That is one point. And his speciality is that he makes the arrangement among the people. That is, he gives discipline or order to the society in large.
Sir, so if God is not meant to be, or these gods are not meant, or deities are not meant to be imitated, what does worship look like then?
I didn't understand. God.
So if God is not meant to be imitated, what does worship look like?
God has not, what does
if gods are not meant to be imitated, then what is the form of worship?
Worship is, you can praise him, you can offer some material like ghee or some food or some other, any other material, whatever way you want to worship. You can utter the name of God. I mentioned that there are 9 ways of bhakti.
The question is exactly that. If the god is not ideal, then why at all he should be worshipped? That should be the question, actually.
Because he is powerful. That answer I have already given. Because he is powerful, therefore he is worshipped.
So it's about fear?
The moment he loses power, nobody will worship him. So just as, and therefore I gave the example of political leaders. The day on which a person loses his seat as a minister, nobody honors him. Because he has no power at all. It is the power which is worshipped, not a god. And gods are symbols of power.
So yesterday we spoke about Rishi being a leader. Today you mentioned him as a sage. So what about the word Muni? What does that mean?
Yes, actually I have written a paper on this concept of Rishi and Muni. So, according to my opinion, the word Muni also means a leader or intellectual leader. And no satisfactory etymology of the word Muni has been given so far. But I have tried to give an etymology of the word Muni. According to my opinion, the word Muni is derived from the Dravidian word Mun. Mun means front. You know the word Dravid Munnetra Kadagam. So, Munnetra means that which is in front. Roughly we can translate the word Purogami with Munnetra as Purogami. So Muni is one who is Purogami. Rishi also is a Purogami, therefore he is righteous. Similarly, Muni is intellectual leader. But the main difference between Rishis and Munis is that Rishis were Pravrittivadi, the Munis were Nivrittivadi, they were ascetics. And therefore they all used to observe silence, and therefore they were Mauna is derived from the word Muni. They used to observe fast. They used to practice penance. On the other hand, Rishis used to perform sacrifices. They wanted to get worldly things like food, wealth, and so on. Rishis were married people. Munis were unmarried people. Rishis wanted many children. Munis didn't want any child at all. So that is the main difference between Rishis and Munis. For example, Vasishtha or Vishwamitra are called Rishis. But Panini is called Muni. Similarly, Katyayana is also called Muni. There are 3 Munis in the field of grammar, Munitrayam. And Patanjali is also Muni, who was a great leader in the field of yoga. He was also a Muni. He was not a Rishi.
So, my other question is, when we talk about the Vedic myths, like the myths which occur in Vedic literature, then there was a phase of course, not, though not linear, epics, the Puranic. How come the Vedic, the literature of the Veds were still relevant when you had all these other forms also existing, which came up later and evolved rather? So I just want to ask the probable reasons of why even it survived for so many years when there was already something which was evolving on another front.
Yes, because people had great respect for Veda, and therefore they preserved Veda in ancient days. And even today also there are many people who are preserving Veda, even though there are many other means of preservation of Vedic texts, still people try to learn these texts by heart. In Pune itself, there may be about 10 persons who know the Rigveda by heart. You can ask him any mantra and they will recite, they will start to say.
How relevant is it?
So there was no question of relevance. They were trying to study Veda for the sake of Vedas, Vedic studies only. And moreover, other literature also was being composed and there was growth. Not all the Vedic rituals are performed today. Not all the Vedic deities are honored even today. Though many people worship many more deities. Yesterday I mentioned that gods like Ganapati are now, tomorrow people will go to Pandharpur, so Vithoba, etc. These are not Vedic deities. But now because we have limited ourselves to Vedic mythology, we are not speaking anything about Vithala or Ganapati or Datta or some other deities. But they are also important and there are numerous devotees of them. But even today, although the number is very small, people are performing Vedic rituals. They are making Vedic studies. And there are some people in universities all over the world. They are studying Sanskrit, they are studying Veda and so on.
And Vedic rituals are also performed before the new deities actually,
yes,
so to say.
That is also. So there is Vedic ritual, there is epic or Puranic ritual and so on. So practically no Vedic ritual is done by ordinary people now. They do image worship, but the concept of image worship is not available in Vedic literature. So there is idol worship or image worship is a comparatively later idea. So there is a growth, there is a change, and you know this phrase, change and continuity. So there is some change in Vedic literature and epic literature, classical literature, modern literature, and perhaps after some 200-300 years, there may be some different religion. We cannot predict what will be there after 200-300 years. Even during last 50 years also, there have been lot of changes. Many new customs have been followed by people. Many old customs have been discontinued. So this change does take place.
So with respect to Vedic mythology,
yes.
What is the key takeout for today?
Huh?
Excuse me. Sir, I mean, there are people waiting with the questions.
Okay. एक प्रश्न असा आहे की कंपेरेटिव्ह मायथॉलॉजीचा तुम्ही उल्लेख केला होता तर त्याच्यामध्ये ग्रीक मायथॉलॉजी आणि इराण म्हणजे अवेस्ता ग्रंथामधला काही संदर्भ आपण घेतला होता तसं इजिप्शियन मायथॉलॉजी त्याच्यामध्ये येऊ शकते का किंवा तसा काही अभ्यास झालेला आहे का
अभ्यास सगळ्या प्रकारचा झालेला आहे पण साम्य तुलनेने कमी आहे जेवढं ज्या मानाने अवेस्ता आणखीन वेद यांच्यामध्ये जितकं साम्य आहे तितकं इतर धर्मांमध्ये किंवा इतर दैवतशास्त्रामध्ये किंवा कर्मकांडात तितकं साम्य नाही आहे पण अजिबातच साम्य नाही असं नाही पण तुलनेने ते कमी आहे अँड दॅट इज द सब्जेक्ट मॅटर विच इज स्टडीड बाय दोज हू आर इंटरेस्टेड इन कम्पॅरिझन सो दे ट्राय टू फाईंड आउट सिमिलॅरिटीज अँड डिसिमिलॅरिटीज येस बट यू मे स्पीक नाऊ
सर
इज देअर एनीबडी एल्स
Sir, with respect to the topic of Vedic mythology,
yes.
What is the key takeout from today's session?
So, I do not understand what exactly...
From today's session, what should I carry home with respect to the subject of Vedic mythology?
I suppose there are more, many locks than keys actually.
No.
That can be taken home, sir.
Sir, what?
I suppose there are many locks than keys that can be taken
many,
home.
Many
locks.
Lock. He uses the word lock.
Lock.
Lock and keys.
No, key means one takeout.
So, you may have a lot of knowledge about the Vedic deities. I don't know whether you were knowing all these things which were mentioned today. Have you seen or have you read Vedic
literature? So it is, with respect to mythology.
So have you read any book on Vedic mythology?
No, sir, I have not read.
Then everything which was told today was a new thing to you. So you have learned hundreds of things today within 1.5 hour.
So these are not myths.
That is a very big profit for you.
No, you were not knowing
something which you could come, which you came to know within 1.5 hours. Perhaps if you read all this literature which, from which I have taken this information, you will require 2-3 years. But all this information you could get in 1.5 hour. So that is how this is very...
No, Varuna I know is god of water, but is how it is mythology?
This is a part of mythology because Varuna is described in numerous ways, and one of the descriptions of Varuna is connected with water, he is connected with ocean. So therefore he is associated with ocean. And therefore I gave example, Shanno Varunaha, this is the motto of Navy, Indian Navy. Because Varuna is closely connected with water and ocean. So the question is whether you were already knowing these things. If you were already knowing these things, this is a kind of repetition for you. But if you were not knowing these things, your knowledge has been increased. That is the gain. Suppose I do not know anything about Chinese language. If somebody gives me some information, there will be a lot of progress in my knowledge.
I think there are no questions.
Anybody else
for today?
If there is anyone.
So, okay.
Still, yes, one more.
For how much period there was amendment being done in the Vedas? Like from the first writings to the last writings of Veda, how much period had gone?
That is very difficult, but at least 2-3 thousand years this progress might have been done. Oldest hymn from the Rigveda and the latest hymn from the Rigveda, there may be a gap of at least 1,000 years, because the language also is different. There are some hymns, the language is very archaic. There are some hymns in the Rigveda, its language is very much similar to the epic language. So for example, there is a hymn called Purusha Sukta. It is very much similar to the classical Sanskrit language. But there are some other hymns which are very difficult. Every word has a different meaning, and it is impossible to know the meaning of that hymn simply by knowing classical Sanskrit. So you have to study Vedic language separately in order to understand such hymns. So there is some gap. So not only language, but even the rituals, mythological details, they also were changing. And there was some progress every day. Only some points have been noted there. Some points we do not know. So on the basis of whatever literature is available, we have to try to draw a picture of the mythology at that time. Yes, anything now?
I suppose so,
yeah. Thank you so much, sir. It was indeed enlightening, and despite having read something about mythology, there was a lot of new things even for us. So thank you so much. So today's session is concluded. See you all tomorrow at 4:45.